Please welcome Pedro Almodóvar. And Emma Suárez and Adriana Ugarte, two Julietas. And Agustin Almodóvar. I want to start by asking you, Pedro, about the stories that this film is based on, and when did you read them, the Alice Munro?
Yes, well, I read them like 10 years ago. And, at that moment I was a follower of Munro writing, so it was not the first time that I... But this specific collection, Runaways, the three stories are part of this collection. For the first time, there were the same protagonist, Juliet. I was really very hooked since the beginning about the first one called Chance. And when I read the whole book, I thought about just making an adaptation for a movie. And you know, it was pretty hard because it seems that the three stories belongs to the same, to the same character, but it's not like that. They are completely independent, but Munro put this Juliet in three different ages, but really the short stories are completely independent. So, the first thing that just to see if how the material will be in my hands, it was just to make a unique story. That was how I started with this material.
And I want you to just briefly talk about the transposition of the stories from North America to Spain.
Yeah, at the beginning I thought, because, the type of family that Munro writes about, it is really American family. We behave and feel in a very different way in our relation with mother, father, brotherhood, brothers, and so on. So it was clear for me that could be my first movie in English, because the Munro is really a specialist in family stories, but that families doesn't exist in Spain. So I thought to make it here in the state of New York. We also find a location in the beach, I make the first draft in Spanish, just with the idea of doing it in English. But there was something that I was not satisfied. Even it's almost what I shoot after, but there was an element that I didn't feel secure. And then I left the script in my table, and I take it again 2 years after. And in that moment, it was when I try just to give a kind of certainty that I didn't feel in English. Obviously, as you can you can hear why. Try to make it. To adapt to the geography and. And the culture of Spain. And once I discovered that it was possible, then I have to make many changes. Sometimes even I had to forget the original and just to move in my own path. But anyway, I have to thank Alice Munro that he inspired me a different way of storytelling. For the first time, I wanted to be very austere, very restrained. she knew even better than I what I thought. And that was a huge adventure for me as a storyteller.
And I just want to ask you a brief question about the spiritual aspect, the you know, when Julieta's daughter shuts herself off in which is quite different from what I imagine in the North American version would be. When she shuts herself away in the religious order. Yeah.
Bueno, en eso, in that aspect, Spain is also very, very different. I mean, anyway, in terms of spirituality, for me, that means the cult of a religion, or to have any credo, is something else and something different. But anyway, in Spain, I mean, even we are a non-confessional country, but reality is that it's a Catholic country. In Julieta, I tell the story of un gran fracaso.
Of a great failure.
El fracaso es que una mujer laica, educada en la libertad por unos padres típicos de los años 60, da a su hija también una educación laica, respetuosa con todos los credos, pero esta mujer fracasa tanto en su propia vida como en la influencia que esta educación tiene en su hija.
So I tell the story of a secular woman who grew up with secular parents in the 1960s and imparts the same kind of education to her daughter, also secular, and following all the credos, but at the same time she fails.
Porque en este tipo, quiero decir, ella fracasa porque sus padres no la educaron para vivir con ese sentimiento de culpa que se convierte en una especie de enfermedad moral y que acaba contagiándole a su hija y que es lo opuesto a una educación laica.
And she fails because what they have not been able to teach her daughter is how to deal with that kind of guilt. And that kind of guilt then runs contrary to the secular education that they had given her.
Y en cualquier caso, los hijos son un misterio. No tengo hijos, pero, y mucho más a los 18 años o a los 12 años. La película habla también de ese misterio por el cual una hija abandona a su madre sin decir una sola palabra. Probablemente para formar parte de un extraño culto del que yo prefiero no hablar, pero siempre es misterioso que un ser humano pueda abandonar de ese modo a otro con el cual ha vivido toda su vida y que parezca que, como dice Alice Munro, que ya no le sirve de para nada.
In any case, I do think that children themselves are a mystery. I myself am not a father, and certainly not of a 12 or 18-year-old. But the film also speaks about the mystery of that abandonment, of a child that just abandons the parent, and then even more broadly, about how we come to abandon the people that we love.
Thank you for a beautiful film. I would just like to deepen that question that you've been discussing and that Mr. Jones put to you. In the third Alice Munro story, there's a long conversation between Julieta and the local minister on the island in which they discuss and debate, and that she's very clear about not just her secularism but her atheism. And that's reduced in the screenplay to really two lines from the retreat counselor that talks about a lack of spiritual dimension in her life, the daughter's life. And that's a critical shift, I think, for us as viewers to some degree to sort of wonder about what really pushed Antia away. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit more deeply about that in terms of how and why you really shifted that character of the minister out of the screenplay altogether.
Sí, me parece que se llama Don ese personaje. Ese personaje es imposible en un pueblo español donde viven los padres.
I think you're referring to a character named Don. And that particular character is kind of impossible in the context of Spain.
I tried at the beginning to include it because it was very important that the daughter at the age of 2 years old, she's present in one agreement, in an argument about faith, about credo, about being married or not. I mean, just how, because this man talks about the idea of one family, how can I say? I mean, the old type of family, because now, I mean, the family, ahora existen muchas formas de familia. Y para este hombre, él no concebía que no estuvieran casados, que la niña no estuviera bautizada. Y sobre todo, este hombre venía, es que en España esto solo podría hacerlo un párroco católico. Pero un párroco católico no va a visitar a las personas, a las casas, no tiene la relación de amistad que este hombre tiene con Sara, con la madre de Julieta. En nuestro país, esa parte que es muy interesante en el libro de Munro, no era posible adaptarlo para España.
So the reason that it's not possible to adapt this to a Spanish context has to do with the fact that now in Spain you have very different kinds of families, not just one kind of nuclear family. And so the sense of, in the stories, the sense of guilt around the fact that they weren't married or that they haven't baptized the child, or even the relationship that the priest can have in a community such as in Munro's stories, is not something that you get from a Catholic priest in Spain, where he would go into the homes and have that kind of intimate relationship with the family.
Para mí, el sentimiento de culpa es más humano y no viene de ningún credo, viene de nuestra propia naturaleza.
And for me, the sense of guilt that I speak of in the film is not necessarily a religious sense of guilt that comes from particular sets of Christian beliefs, but that it's actually integral to humanity, in a sense, to be human.
En el caso de Julieta, o sea, Julieta se culpa de dos situaciones de las cuales realmente ella no es culpable.
And in Julieta's case, she actually feels guilty and blames herself for two situations of which, in fact, she's not even to blame.
Ella se culpa de no haber hablado lo suficiente con el hombre que encuentra en el tren porque, y se acusa a sí misma de no haber tenido la sensibilidad de darse cuenta de que este hombre atravesaba un estado de ánimo muy depresivo.
So first, she feels guilty about not having spoken to the man on the train, of not having been able to recognize the state of mind in which he was in, and to have had the sensibility or the sensitivity to actually speak to him and make him feel comfortable.
Se siente también culpable de haber abandonado a la madre haciendo su vida, para hacer su propia vida. O sea, se siente culpable de haber sido tan egoísta como para elegir a la familia que ha formado con el pescador y, sin embargo, dejar a su madre prisionera en su habitación con su padre. Pero, bueno, es también algo que uno entiende como algo humano.
And she also feels guilty about the fact that, in a sense, she has abandoned her mother in order to pursue her relationship with a fisherman and build a family with a fisherman, and has left her, in a sense, in order to become a prisoner. But even that sense of guilt humanizes her.
Y después también se siente culpable de dejar al marido con la palabra en la boca y no tener ninguna oportunidad de recuperar esa discusión.
And she also feels guilty about the fact that she then leaves her husband halfway through a discussion and that she never again has the chance to pick it back up.
Es un sentimiento muy humano y ella es injusta consigo misma, pero forma parte de nuestra naturaleza. Pero su culpabilidad es una culpabilidad laica. No hay una razón porque pertenezca a algún credo ni nada de eso. Está dentro de nuestra naturaleza.
And in fact, she does feel this kind of guilt, but it's important to understand that the guilt is a secular kind of guilt. It's a guilt that really belongs to us as human beings and that is not necessarily imparted by religion or religious beliefs.
Y curiosamente, cuando pensé hacer la película en español, es cuando apareció con mucha fuerza este elemento de culpabilidad. Creo que si lo hubiera hecho aquí, en Nueva York, y en inglés, no hubiera tenido para mí tanta importancia ese sentimiento.
And in fact, going back to the moment in which I adapted a story that I was imagining to be in English and moved it to Spain, it wasn't until I was dealing with it as a Spanish story that the sense of guilt actually came into the script. And thus I realized that I couldn't have even made that same story in an American or Canadian context.
I wanted to ask your two Julietas, Emma and Adriana, what it was like to act in light of one another, but to be in separate parts of the movie. When you saw the movie, how that changed your sense of your characters in relation to one another.
Well, hi, thank you. Well, yeah, when I knew that we're gonna play the same character, I remember that we called each other because we wanna see each other and celebrate, you know, like this incredible and this huge gift for us. And yeah, I think we want to talk about Julieta. We wanted to prepare the character, to build the character, and maybe, I don't know, just how we see the character, maybe how she suffers or how she talks and how she walks. And when Pedro brought us together, then I realized that the process was gonna be very, very different, because Pedro was the real chef of all the process, and he directed us separately. And it's like a miracle, because we didn't prepare the character together. And it's not only he worked with us through very, very different ways. He didn't give me any references, and he gave Emma a lot of references. So the process was absolutely different and complex. And well, when I saw the film, I was like, yeah, like shocked, because I couldn't believe how the character was the same and was Julieta all the time. And I didn't miss the young Julieta, and I didn't miss the old one, because Julieta was just one woman, and it was great, incredible. But it's not that we're married.
Hello, I'm so sorry because I want to speak Spanish, if you don't mind, because when I speak about Julieta, it's so deeply, and I don't really find the words to explain my feelings. My work with Pedro fue muy interesante, un proceso muy creativo en el que además tuve tiempo de preparar y de componer este magnífico personaje. Yo necesitaba referencias para bucear en el dolor de Julieta, y él me habló de un magnífico libro que para mí fue determinante, El año del pensamiento mágico, de Joan Didion. Me habló también de... Bueno, casualmente, cuando me llamó para hacer la película, yo estaba leyendo el libro de Alice Munro, los relatos de Alice Munro. Me dio también referencias de actrices y películas como... Sorry.
So I will say that it was a very interesting and fascinating process to delve into the character of Julieta. And Pedro did, in fact, give me a lot of references that I could work with. One of them was John Didion's The Year of Magical Thinking, for example. And also he gave me some references to actresses and...
Las Horas, Julianne Moore, Meryl Streep, Jean Moreau. En Ascensor al Cadalso.
In Elevators to the Gallows.
Jean Moreau.
Jean Moreau, dile que, para que se explique, porque Jean Moreau, I mean, it is just to add just something. I mentioned Jean Moreau, because Jean Moreau in Ascensor para el Cadalso, the Louis Malle's movie, she walked a lot in Paris. She walked the whole night. And I love the way that Jean Moreau walks. So that was the reason. I mean, obviously, with the book of Joan Didion, I think it's one of the more impressive books that I read about Lost. But I wanted just to explain why more.
That's it.
Hello. I want to ask that the females from Almodóvar films are most of all strong women that have to struggle with the world and all the difficulties ahead. And I wanted to ask him if he's following the US elections and if he finds out that Hillary Clinton is a bit of an Almodóvar woman somehow because she has to struggle with...
Yeah. In his next film, maybe.
Yeah. Does anyone have a choice about following the U.S. election?
Absolutely, absolutely. yes. I think she's very strong, and you know, I'm very surprised because 20 years ago, I couldn't think that in one moment like this, I could be like praying for Hillary to be the president of the United States. And this is the situation. So, I mean, in this country, it is the first Almodóvar girl that I can imagine. Absolutely. We are very concerned in Spain also, you know, about these elections.
Buenos días. Tendrán que traducirte esta, Pedro, que pienso en español también. Se me hace muy difícil preguntarte esto en inglés. Dos cosas. ¿Qué piensas del momento que vive el cine español? Yo pienso que se ha abierto mucho. Pienso que está como copiando mucho la fórmula, ¿no? Hollywoodense. Ese es mi parecer, humildemente. Y saber también tu opinión sobre el cine latinoamericano, que lo has apoyado, ¿no? Con películas tan interesantes como Relatos Salvajes. Nada, básicamente eso.
So there's two questions. The first question is what Pedro thinks about the way in which Spanish cinema has really kind of opened up to the world and seems to be copying the Hollywood formula. And the second question is what you think about Latin American cinema, since you've also been producing some films in Latin America.
You know, I don't know exactly what titles do you mean, because I don't have the feeling that in Spain they are like imitating the Hollywood way of productions. I don't know if you mentioned, because actually there are like two thrillers really that could be inspired in the American thrillers. But I mean, the way, the budget, everything in Spain are so different that it seems to me that we cannot name it with the same word, because I mean, if you want me, I can tell you what is the average production in Spain, and is, well, Agustín, my brother knows better than I, es alrededor de 2 millones.
Sí, less. $2 million, sí.
$2 million or less. So, you know, it's something completely different. If we try to imitate, it is impossible to do it. And the thinking, you know, in general about the movies made in our language, I think it's a good moment. I mean, for example, last week I saw Neruda, and I think it is the best movie that I saw this year. And I'm a moviegoer. I mean, I used to go every weekend once or twice to a theater to see movies. So I think we are in good shape. Also, we are producing now the new movie of Lucrecia Martel, the Argentinian director, and also we are very happy with that. This is very convenient for El Deseo, which is our production company, to be in contact with other directors of a Latin American country, because we have something in common, something huge, which is the language. And I think that the, just let's say, the movies in Spanish language, they are now in a very good shape. They giving me a lot of pleasure as a spectator and also as producer with my brother. You know, we have it very present, and we want to keep on working in both sides, but in Spanish.
Hi, hola, Pedro. Quick question about the final song by Chavela Vargas. Can you tell me about the significance of Si No Te Vas, the song at the end, and why Chavela Vargas was your photo, and we hear the song at the end?
To the other guy. I think I forgot the main thing. Perhaps because you didn't name the titles, perhaps you mentioned the type of Spanish movies produced by TV, like the last movie or Bayona, or the last movie of Alejandro Amenábar. Specifically, in this sense, I mean, the TV production system looks like a studio compared to the other wave of produce in Spain. So it's just to... Chavela Vargas, yeah. You know, I thought since the beginning when I wrote the script, I thought to be more austere just because of the style of Munro. So, I mean, for me, just to be not, I mean, my personality and my character is very baroque. So what I tried to avoid, it was, I mean, I try to make a drama, not a melodrama, which is my natural inclination. Inclination, you can say that? Really? It's so simple sometimes, you know, the English language. So I try to control myself in the way of not to make the Julieta singing something, not to use the humor, because, you know, during the rehearsals, above all with the first Julieta, because the other is suffering so much that it was not a way just to. But during the rehearsal, I mean, there was a room for humor and something, it was very funny. But at the end of the day, I just abandoned that and leave it like a way for the actresses to experiment and to have, I mean, the experience of having some fun during, not during the shooting, but during a part of her character that is, it is not in the movie. So I try to avoid all these elements of that identify myself, even, but at the end, Chavela Vargas came to my mind like the best artist, the best singer to talk about to be abandoned. Yo creo que nadie como Chavela Vargas ha cantado en el escenario a la mujer abandonada.
I don't think anybody has sung to the heart, say, of the abandoned woman better than Chavela Vargas.
Verdaderamente en escenario se convertía, no sé si alguno lo habéis visto, supongo que tú sí, se convertía en una especie de sacerdotisa de la mujer abandonada.
I don't know if any of you had the
chance. Si eso fuera un credo.
I don't know if any of you had the chance to see her on stage, but when she was on stage, she would somehow transform into sort of a priestess of the abandoned woman.
Y por otra parte, esta, la letra de esta canción podría ser la continuación perfecta de lo que va diciendo Emma Suárez en el coche.
And also the lyrics to the song could really be almost a continuation of the dialogue that Emma Suárez's character is saying at the end of the film.
Si tú te vas, en ese mismo instante muero yo. So if you leave, in that precise moment, I die. So it was a way also to complete the dialogue of Emma Suárez and to end the movie with this line in Spanish, very strong and at the same time extremely simple.
Three thank yous and a question. Thank you for showing us the intensity of adolescent love and the passion of it without putting it on the screen. It was just so full of these two teenage girls falling in love and needing to be with each other. Thank you for casting Marion.
You are welcome.
Thank you for casting Marion and Lorenzo with the actors that we recognize and are so much a part of your history.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I mean, this movie, it's for many reasons, something new for me. One of them is that almost the entire cast are actors and actresses that I didn't work with before, with the two exceptions you mentioned it, Rosy De Palma and Dario Grandinetti. For Rosy, I wrote, that was really when I was writing, this is the only character that I have in mind just the face. And I want to give to Rosy something completely different of what she's doing now. She's working more than ever in Spain, but in Europe and in general, but basically always linked with parody, humor, you know, always. So I wanted her just to make this, which is like como el ama de llaves de Rebecca. Someone really sinister and ugly and terrible.
Yeah, like Rebecca's housekeeper.
Yeah. about Dario Grandinetti, I mean, this, I also thought about him because for this small character, I needed someone very strong, just like to tell the spectator everything that the spectator cannot see in the movie. That, I mean, his only presence suggests all that part that we don't see. And also because for me, Dario is the best actor. He has to be sitting down in one hospital close to a woman or that is in coma or very or very sick. Para mí me parece que es el hombre que mejor representa el consuelo que una mujer enferma necesita en un hospital.
For me, he's the man that best represents the kind of soothing that a woman laying in a hospital needs.
So I'm glad that you love them.
And thank you for the concept of secular guilt. But my question has to do with the actor's choice and your choice emotionally around the lines, I'm going to take a walk, which is how she deals with when he says what he has just said to her, that you and Anita come first, and she is trying to process what she's just been told by Marion. And instead of the high drama scene that could have been a part of this film, the choice is made for her to say, I'm going to take a walk. I know that feeling, but I also know the passion that could have been in that moment too. So Pedro, why did you make that choice with her to bring it down rather than up?
Sí, en principio, Julieta está muy enfadada porque acaba de descubrir que su marido se acostó con su amiga 12 años antes.
So Julieta is upset because she's just found out that he slept with her good friend 10 or 12 years earlier.
Pero también se da cuenta de que ella sabía, conocía esa relación desde que llegó a la casa.
But at the same time she realizes that she knew something about that relationship from the second that she arrived at the house.
Entonces no se siente, es una mujer educada y cree que no puede comportarse como una ama de casa italiana, gritándole al marido y haciéndole reproches.
And she's a very well-educated woman, so she knows that at this point she can't quite behave like an Italian housewife screaming and reproaching him.
Porque realmente porque piensa que no tiene derecho a hacerlo.
Because she actually feels she has no right to do so.
Y eso le crea una enorme frustración.
And that makes her very frustrated.
Y también una gran decepción por acerca del marido.
But she also feels disappointed in him.
En ese momento está pensando volver a dar clases y entonces está coge los libros para ponerse a preparar una lección.
And at that point she's already thinking of going back to teaching, so she just grabs her books and leaves with the idea that she's going to prepare a class.
Pero por supuesto ella piensa continuar esa conversación.
But she of course intends to continue that conversation.
Pero está, quiero decir, se siente demasiado agria como para hacerlo en ese momento.
But she feels a little too bitter to be able to do it at that moment.
Lo terrible del personaje de Julieta, lo que hace de Julieta un personaje trágico, es que ella no va a tener nunca la oportunidad de continuar esa conversación.
And what is really sad for Julieta, and what really makes Julieta into a tragic character, is the fact that she's never going to be able to continue that conversation.
Y es terriblemente injusto.
And it's an incredibly unfair thing.
Pero ella, la despedida de su marido, para ella la asocia a la despedida del hombre del tren. Estos dos hombres, lo último que vieron fue la espalda de Julieta abandonándolos. Y eso es algo que moralmente se le convierte en un sentimiento insoportable.
And it's unfair, but really what that brings her back to is the man on the train, and both men, the last thing that they saw before they died was Julieta's back, and that really generates a lot of guilt in Julieta.
That's all the time we have for today, but I want to thank you all for coming. And Pedro, welcome back to the New York Film Festival.